Okay, so quickly let us recap what we did in the previous class. Up till now in this lesson, we have learned about the three sectors of our Indian economy, the primary, tertiary and the secondary sector. We have seen what kind of activities happened in these three sectors, and then we have also seen the contribution of these three sectors to our economy, how they actually all come together and contribute to the GDP, that is the gross domestic product of our country. We learned this concept of gross domestic product, what GDP actually means and why is it such an important number for any country's economic indicator. Then we also learned about employment. We learned about how employment is actually allocated in these sectors and how over the years we have been seeing that the people, number of people employed in the tertiary sector is actually increasing. Even though the employment requirement of the primary sector, it's a highly labor-intensive sector, the primary sector. But the bifurcation is that unskilled labor are required more in the primary sector, whereas skilled labor is mainly required in the tertiary sector. So that is how it is. And since, you know, we have been increasing the number of people who are literate and getting educated, that's the reason why the people moving to tertiary sector is much more. So the higher the GDP contribution from the tertiary sector, it is an economic indicator which shows that this country is more developed. So highly developed nations or already completely developed nations, you will see in their GDP, the contribution of the tertiary sector is much, much more as compared to the other two sectors. So this is what we had all learned up till now. And we also learned about underemployment, wherein people who are educated but are not employed, and excessive number of people getting employed in any particular place. That was what underemployment was. Okay, so now let us learn about
this. Yes, sir.
You want me to speak a little louder, is it? Okay. Okay, is my voice clear now? Okay.
Yes,
sir. Okay. So now we have the NREGA, that is the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. Also, it is also called as MGNREGA, that is Mahatma Gandhi.
Launched in 2005.
Yeah, so launched in 2005, started by the central government. This is mainly made a law implementing the right to work in 200 districts in India. So all those who are in need of work will get guaranteed 100 days work. And if the government fails to do so, means provide them any employment, then they are entitled to receive an unemployment allowance from the government. There's some problem with this here. Okay. The work will be the work. One minute, please. I'm having some problem. This page. Okay, so the work will be the type which will in future help to increase the production from land. So most of the work over here which is given through the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, it is unskilled, doesn't have to be skilled, a little bit of skill maybe, and according to that the work will be given to those people. And in case the government fails to provide any work or allocate any work to those individuals, those people are entitled to receive unemployment allowance. Okay.
Sir, even 1/3 of the seats are reserved for women.
In NREGA?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, allocation is there. Yes. Okay. So, till here, is it clear to everyone the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act?
Yes, sir.
So, now let us learn about the main two sectors in which, you know, employment is divided. The organized sector and the unorganized sector. Now, the unorganized sector is very huge in India compared to the organized sector. We will see that there are more laborers in the unorganized sector. This is mainly because there are many, you know, legal hurdles where people find it easier to have people working in the unorganized sector. But the sign of any developed country would be having more people working in the organized sector. Now let us see what the difference actually is between the organized and unorganized. So the organized sector, in terms of employment, where the work is regular and the people have assured work, means they have a work 100% guarantee that their work is there. It is the organization, wherever they are working in the organized sector, it is an entity which is registered by the government. And it follows the rules and regulations, the labor laws, whatever is laid down by the government. And
sir,
for what happened, Sagar?
The terms and conditions are
there. Terms and conditions are there. There is a formal procedure for getting employment in the organized sector. Qualifications are required. And based on these qualifications, then the employment is given to that person in the organized sector. And the person would be entitled to a monthly salary. Along with that, he will be entitled to receive a pension, a provident fund. Depending upon the quality of his work and the years of work he has put in any particular organization, there would also be a gratuity fund. So there are various kinds of benefits. Also, they would be getting some health benefits like maybe a health allowance, a medical allowance, a dearness allowance, different kinds of allowances also are there. So these are all things which are specified by the government under the labor laws, and based on that, the person gets employment. So this is how the organized sector works. It is a completely formal process, and for registered entities which are registered by the government, they are subject to all kinds of rules and regulations, whichever is given by the government. So this is the organized sector. Whereas now the benefits for the employees, as I said, is we get paid leave unless and until the allocated leaves have expired, and any leaves above that mean the person might not get paid. You get payment during holidays. You get provident fund. The person gets gratuity depending upon the numbers of years of service he has put in. There are medical benefits for himself and his family. On retirement, normally government employees, they get pensions. So these are the benefits for people who work in the organized sector. Whereas a stark contrast to that is the unorganized sector, wherein it is characterized by small scattered units and which are largely outside the control of the government. Many of these people, normally they would be unskilled. The rules and regulations are not at all followed, and normally they consist of very low paid jobs which are not regular. Over here in the unorganized sector, you will see that there is normally a large scale exploitation of the people who work in the unorganized sector. They can be removed from their work at any point of time, and the person who is working over there in that sector also can actually leave without even having to give any notice period to the employer. The person doesn't require any kind of qualification, official qualifications, for getting a job in this organized sector, the unorganized sector. The work is the work that he gets, that person gets, is very, very not stable. It is highly unstable. It could be there today, tomorrow it could disappear all of a sudden without any kind of intimation, earlier notice, nothing. So it is extremely unstable kind of a work, very, very dangerous. But these very extremely small organizations, smaller people, small proprietary concerns, most of them prefer to take people in the unorganized sector, since they do not have to follow the government rules and regulations. So So the disadvantage for the employers is there is no provision for overtime, paid leave, holidays, leave due to sickness. There is no provision whatsoever. The employment is not at all secure, no security whatsoever. Farmers who work on their own and hire laborers as and when they require, this is a very good example. Construction workers, this is another very good example. Laborers who are used in construction, they might be there today, tomorrow they might not be there. A totally new set of people would be there. In case they ask for more pay, they could be immediately removed from the job and another person would be put over there. So lots of disadvantages for people who are working in the unorganized sector. So what kind of protection can be made for people who work in this unorganized sector? Setting up of small scale industries in semi-rural areas. There are plenty of land which is available where small scale industries can be set up. These small scale industries can be also run as home industries, house industries, cottage industries. Whatever specialty is there in that area, those areas can be converted to small scale industries. These initiatives are being done by the government. Implementing many programs such as NREGA 2005 in these rural areas. Creating job opportunities in service sector like schools, tourism, hospitals, ancillary activities like transportation industries over there, tourism, tour guides, transportation people, drivers, conductors, all these kinds of jobs, hospitals, workers who help around in the hospitals. So these kinds of alternative jobs for unskilled people can be created and allow credit at a very lower rate. Credit over here means giving of loans. Loans can be given either by banks or by government banks. They can be given at a lower rate for people who come under this unorganized sector. So these are the things which the government could possibly do to help the people in the unorganized sector. Yeah, that is absolutely right, Prasanna. The IT sector mainly saw the boom initially through call centers and business process outsourcing, which we call as BPOs. This BPO and this call centers, this initially grew to a huge extent mainly because of the lesser cost of labor in India. Now, the same kind of work, if it were to be done by the US in a US country, the amount of cost incurred by that company would be very high. So to reduce the cost, these works were outsourced to India because, as I said in the previous class also, we have a very large, English-speaking labor force, which is not there in many of the countries. So this is a huge advantage for us. But again, the cost is very less. And so that is why it adds to the profit of that foreign company where these people are used, are working. Okay. Yeah, so till here, is it clear to everybody about organized and unorganized sector? Anybody is having any doubts?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let us look at companies in terms of ownership, that is public and private sector companies. So under public sector companies, we have companies which are organized by the government. So these public sector companies mainly grew into importance after our independence because we really did not have any much of industries in India. And the government took it upon themselves to create industries in each and every different kind of field work and to provide facilities to the people in the tertiary sector also, like public transport facilities, electrical facilities, hospitals for people, schools for the people. So over here, this is where the public sector started growing and started developing. Industries, in the sense, in the public sector industries, there were many industries set up so that the industrial base of the country would become strong and support the primary sector. because without the industrial base, the secondary sector would not develop. So that is the reason why the government initiated over here and they started growing more and more companies under the public sector. So very soon this public sector companies started being looked at as a very stable source of employment for the people. If you see in the earlier years of the public sector, there was hardly any kind of accountability for the people working in the public sector. Even today it is known that, you know, a person gets a government job, he's going to need a very nice and comfortable life. But the effect which this has is that the quality of work comes down to a very large extent. Whenever there is no accountability for any position or any work which is there, the quality of work is definitely going to come down. Now, if you see private companies, in a very stark contrast, there is large amount of competition. If you go to buy anything, say for example, let us take for example a television, for that matter. You go to the market to buy a television, there is a large variety over there. And the competition is very fierce. The pricing they put over there is very fierce. The competition is extremely strong, so that people are there, the company is able to sell their product more in numbers. And to supplement that, to support that, they would see that there is a lot of customer service support also which is given. So the company over here is not only accountable for the sale of the product, they are also accountable, they make themselves accountable for the service which is provided. This is the private sector. This is how they try to retain the customer and see that they grow in size. This is the responsibility the private sector has taken upon themselves because they are profit driven. This is the idea over here. The private sectors are mainly profit driven. So they see to it that they are able to retain their customer base and also enhance and grow their customer base. Because unless and until they make those profits, it would not be possible for them to continue in that business. But on the other side, we have the public sector, which is not profit driven. Okay, once you understand this idea, why public sector behaves the way it does behave, why things move so slowly in the public sector, or why things move so slowly in a government office, the main thing over here is because they are not profit driven. Since they are not profit driven, the urge or the need to do more, to make the customer happy, is not there. They are not bothered about whether the customer stays with them or the customer moves to a different place. And in fact, this is more so in terms of, you know, government departments. Government departments which are used for the service of the public, you know, like a water department or electricity department. The electricity department, yeah. For example, our HESCOM, Hubli Electricity Supply Company. Now, HESCOM knows that they are the only people who are supplying electricity in entire Karnataka. There is no other company which supplies electricity. So, all said and done, how much ever you shout at them, how much ever you complain to them, you have no other place to go. Correct. You have to get electricity only from HESCOM. So, it is a monopoly. It is a monopoly which only they are the only people who are providing electricity in the market. In contrast, you see phone services, telephone services or cellular services. If I am not happy with BSNL, BSNL is a public sector company. If I am not happy with the services which BSNL provides me, I can very easily go to Vodafone, I can very easily go to Jio, I can very easily go to Airtel. I can get those services that I need. So this is a competitive sector. The private sector over here will fulfill my needs. But whereas that is not there in the electricity. There is no private player over here. If there were private companies in the field of electricity also, then definitely we would be having uninterrupted power supply at more competitive rates, best of service whenever there is a problem. So we will see a lot of change. So it is up for a good debate whether, you know, we need to move things more into the private sector and have lesser public sector companies. So some of the public services which are offered by the government, the railways, post office, hospitals, libraries, schools. We know that in the Indian Railways also, we do not have any private players over here. For competition of the post, we have n number of courier services. For schools and hospitals also, we have seen now that we have many private schools, many private hospitals. Of course, the affordability by the common people is again a question mark. Public sector, is it clear to everybody? Any doubts?
No, sir.
Yeah, that's right, Prasanna. Public sector is more of a service than a business. Mainly, it is not profit driven. That's the reason why the motivation to do better is not there. If it were to be profit driven, then the motivation would be there to do better and serve better. In contrast, the private sector is organized by private individuals and it does not provide fixed employment and fixed working hours to the workers. Means over here, the person who is working in the private sector, he needs to prove his capabilities, he needs to prove that he is worthy of that job position which is given. It is not guaranteed that once I get a job in a private industry that I will stick to that job or I will be retained at that job for the rest of my life. Unless and until I prove myself in the private sector, unless and until I show to the company that I am a valuable asset for that company, the company would not have any need for that particular person. So, the employment is not guaranteed, even though it is under the organized sector. It is guaranteed only unless and until that person proves that he is worthy of that position. The main aim over here is to make profits for themselves, totally and entirely profit-driven sector. And examples, there are plenty of examples all around you. We see lots of private companies, the companies owned by the Birla Group of Industries, Reliance, which is owned by the Ambanis, the Tatas are there, plenty of companies over here. So this is entirely the private sector which we have. So the qualities of the public sector are job security. Nobody is going to touch your job once you are employed in a government office. Lots of benefits. In fact, every 3 years there is a revision in the pay scale. The government announces something which is called as a pay commission, and in this the fifth pay commission, the seventh pay commission, every now and then there is a revision in that pay commission and the salaries over there increase. So plenty of benefits for people working in the public sector and a very relaxed atmosphere. You don't have to follow any kind of a strict dress code. You can come in however you want. Maybe nowadays in the recent years there have been a little bit more strictness in the government offices, but otherwise it's a very relaxed atmosphere. People can go leisurely, come back leisurely. There is no kind of a stress or strain over there in the public sector. But whereas in the private sector, there's more opportunity for people to grow in that company. If the company grows, then the people working in that company also grow. The longer you serve in that company, the more benefits you have. So it's very competitive in the private sector. The jobs tend to pay higher, definitely higher pay for better work and higher pay. More prestige than the private sector, and people know that you are efficient in your work. That is the reason why you are working in the private sector. And much less bureaucracy. Bureaucracy actually means the involvement of lots of complications and government paperwork, which is normally called as red tape. This bureaucracy is something which is normally involved with government companies. The involvement of politicians with these government companies, the involvement of government related work, paperwork, everything has to follow a strict procedure, and it will take his own sweet time to move from one desk to other desk. This is usually called as bureaucracy, and the person who is sitting behind that desk must be made happy. If he is not happy, then that file will not move to the other desk. So this is called as bureaucracy. This bureaucracy you will not see in the private sector. The work which is given in the private sector is purely on merit. It doesn't depend whether you are from a from upper caste, lower caste, to the social background, your economic background, lower economic background, higher economic background, whatever it is, if you are capable of doing that work, then definitely that work will be given to you in the private sector. If you are up to it, if you are having the skills for that work, if you are qualified for that work, based on your merit, you will get the work in the private sector. But whereas in the public sector, it is more or less the class that you belong to, the socio-economic condition that you belong to. There are reservation for so many different kinds of entities, different kinds of classes in the public sector, and based on that, the what is that work is given. There many times, you know, people say that India is a country of the reserved and not a country of the deserved. You know, that is how our public sector is. In the government sector, reserved categories are the people who work in the public sector, whereas deserved categories are the people who work in the private sector. If you deserve that job, if you prove yourself capable of doing that job, then definitely in the private sector there is a place for you. But whereas in the public sector, if there is a reservation for that post, the person, whoever is reserved for that post, will get the job. It doesn't depend upon whether he is capable of doing that job, whether he has the knowledge for that job. That really doesn't matter over there. So that is the public sector and the private sector. So is this understood by everybody? HAL comes under private or public sector. HAL is a public sector undertaking. There is a ownership by the government in the public sector in HAL. Hindustan Aeronautics Limited. Okay, so any doubts by anybody up till now? Is this clear to everyone? What about others?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Clear, huh? Okay, good. Good, okay. So now let us quickly recapitulate what we have done in this lesson. In fact, this is almost the end of the lesson. This lesson mainly tells us about the three sectors of our Indian economy, the primary, secondary and the tertiary sector. It tells us what kind of industries come under these sectors, how the development or the growth of these industries have moved over the years after independence, the contribution of these sectors to our gross domestic product, that is the GDP, and how the contribution over the years, we have seen a movement from the primary to the tertiary sector, wherein the tertiary sector is now contributing more and more and employing more and more people. But of course, the tertiary sector is a sector which is going to employ more skilled labor, but whereas the primary sector would employ more unskilled labor, right? And then we also learned about employment, the problem of underemployment in India. And then we also learned about how the labor is organized in India. We have the organized sector and we have the unorganized sector. Mainly the unorganized sector is where people, they get exploited because the work is not guaranteed. There is no security of the job. The person could have the work today, tomorrow he could be removed. But whereas the organized sector has more benefits, people get all the benefits of employment as per the government rules and regulations in the organized sector. And then finally, lastly, we also learned about the differences between the public sector companies and the private sector companies. How public sector companies, mainly they were set up after independence to strengthen the industrial base of India. And also the government driven departments, all the government departments come under the public sector. And then there are the private sector companies wherein they are more profit driven. And because of this hunger for more and more profit, they are highly competitive and try to offer the best which is there to the customer. So this was all about the sectors of the Indian economy. So now to your doubts, Ankit has a doubt over here. Ekas factory is government or private? Ekas is I am not mistaken, aeronautical spare parts which it manufactures. This is a private company, it is not owned by the government. It is set up inside the specialized economic zone that is there near Hattargi, if I am not mistaken. Right? So, but it's a private company. Okay. Yeah. So I think if there are no more doubts, we can close this class over here.